KOCT, its board of directors, staff, and the City of Oceanside do not support nor promote any candidates. We provide the following program as a public service for voters. All candidates have been invited to participate in this program, but not all were able to or chose to do so.
Good afternoon and welcome to a special election edition of North County Roundtable. My name is Kent Davey and I am pleased to moderate today's forum on Proposition L, a November 3 ballot measure that would allow construction of the North River Farms project by developer Integral Communities. The ballot measure would rezone 176 acres of land in the South Morro Hills area north of the San Luis River, Ray River, and Highway 76. The current zoning is agriculture and allows subdivision to a minimum lot size of 2.5 acres. The 213-acre project, which would straddle North River Road west of Wilshire Road, projects up to 585 housing units, a commercial village, some agricultural operations, parks, and open spaces. The developers have agreed to a number of amenities and improvements to the area and the city. The project has sparked controversy since it was first proposed in 2016. Ballot measure was unsuccessfully challenged in court, leaving the matter up to you, the voters. Here to discuss Measure L and speaking for the measure is Tanya Manas Castaneda, Communications Director for Yes on L and a principal of PRM Consulting in San Diego. Speaking against the proposition is Dennis Martinek, a former member of the Oceanside Planning Commission and South Morro Hills residents. We have about 60 minutes available for this forum. I'd like to start with brief opening statements. Ms. Castaneda.
Well, thank you for having us here. Excited to be here to talk about Measure L. A vote of yes on Measure L is a vote to preserve agriculture. North River Farms is a farming community. It is a community where it will preserve a working farm the size of 67 football fields. That's an 88-acre farm. And this community has a lot of benefits. It has benefits on the site and benefits off the site. On the site, we have a very sustainable community rooted in agricultural tradition with an agricultural education center, 10 miles of trails, 4 public parks, and lots more. And then off-site, there's a lot of road improvements at no cost to taxpayers, as well as a new fire station, new truck, new staffing for fire, to increase response times at no cost to taxpayers at all. So unfortunately, Measure L and North River Farms has been the victim of a lot of scare tactics. And you're gonna hear today contention that North River Farms does not preserve agriculture. You're gonna hear statements that traffic will be worse and that fire risk is there. I'm gonna tell you all about North River Farms and how it actually is gonna improve a lot of those areas.
Okay, we'll get to that. Dennis.
Okay. I believe that's a lot of pie in the sky as far as the promises that have been made. And it may be in concept or maybe ideal you'd like it to be that way, but that's not the way it is now. If you look at a site map or site plan of the project, it's 585 units that generates over 7,000 auto trips a day. And it does consume the 176 acres of prime agricultural land. So it's generated a lot of opposition because it's not consistent with our present general plan, and it's not consistent with the planning that's going on now to promote agriculture through agritourism and agrivision.
Okay, what do you see as the major advantage to the citizens of Oceanside in allowing this development to go through?
Well, one of the things that's really clear is that this is gonna provide the kind of housing that our working families need. The average median price, the median price of a home in San Diego County is just growing higher and higher, and this will provide homes that working families, nurses, firefighters, teachers can afford, as well as some restricted affordable units. So the homes are a big part of it, but most importantly, the preservation of agriculture is gonna be a key benefit. This is an area where, yes, there is some commercial farming happening now, not local produce. What's being grown there is being shipped and trucked long distances elsewhere. This is going to create a new locally sourced fresh food supply chain for Oceanside.
Okay. And what do you see as the major disadvantage to the citizens of Oceanside?
The destruction of agriculture in the area. It's a situation where this 176 units are going to be homes. And again, if you look at the site map of it, and there's a visual that will be shown, and it's also available on the city's website. If you go to Oceanside City and look for NRF, okay, North mm-hmm. River Farms, right. you'll see a variety of different analysis. And if you look at the site maps, it's very clear that it's a housing project. It's not a farm project. What they're proposing as being agriculture is really, there are some community, not farms, but gardens. And these are paid for by the homeowners association of the people who would be living there. It's not affordable either.
Okay. When you talk about affordable housing, isn't it the case that the housing prices are likely to be $500,000 and up?
You know, right now I think it's important to remember that the median housing price is 600 something thousand mm-hmm. in our county. There are a lot of homes in Oceanside that start in the 1 million range, and people can't afford to buy in to a lot of homes that we've lived in for a long time here in Oceanside. They can't afford to buy those homes. These would create more moderate priced homes.
Okay. Isn't it the case that Oceanside, according to the housing analysis that has been done, needs 5,443 units of housing before the end of 2029, I believe.
2029.
So wouldn't this, wouldn't 585 houses go a long way to helping satisfy that?
Well, it's in the wrong area. It's a sprawl development. And the city abides by the state almost a mandate, at least the strong suggestions that they look for smart growth housing. And the city has identified, our planners have done an excellent job of identifying the corridors and the sites where that housing can be built. And they have done that for this last term for all the way through 2029.
Mm-hmm. But isn't it the case that it's unlikely that a developer is going to come in and do a substantial amount of infill development?
Well, not true. You know, they will. The land and the sites are available. City's also talking about converting some commercial. So there are plenty of sites. They don't have to go against the state suggestions and build in a sprawl area or a non-smart growth area. Also, as far as affordable goes, if you look at the Kaiser-Marston economic analysis, they say that someone living there would have to have an income of $167,000 a year. And that's because of the high assessments for the different things that the homeowners there are going to be required to pay for over and above property taxes.
I assume that is a reference to HOA and Melrose.
Well, fees. I actually want to go back to what he said about sprawl, if
okay.
I may. Talk about sprawl development. This is the opposite of sprawl. This is smart growth. You know, this is walking distance to a transit center, not a bus stop, a transit center where 5 bus lines go through, connections to some of these major regional bus routes. And this is actually a transit center that's been designated by SANDAG as a smart growth node. This is a perfect place to build something like this that celebrates agriculture and farming and provides housing. The figures he's quoting from the Kaiser-Marston study are about the median price. Mm-hmm. We're not talking about where it starts. The starting price is lower than that. And quite frankly, when you have a dual income couple, you're gonna make a good amount of money, enough to buy a house that's at least the median price. But what I'm gonna say about this is an area right near an elementary school, right near a regional park, right near a transit center. There are loads of infrastructure lines right along there, and it's the perfect place to build this.
You said that transportation hub is within walking distance. Where is that located at?
It is 1/2 mile. It's the San Luis Rey Transit Center.
Okay. The regional housing needs allocation says that about 36 or well over a third of Oceanside's housing needs need to be for low income and very low income. Does this proposal address any housing in either of those categories?
Yes, thank you for asking that. We've got 60 restricted, rent-restricted, affordable apartments. And what's great about this is we have a local home builder, Integral Communities. They are locally based, and they have a track record of building quality, inclusionary housing right in Oceanside. They built Oceanside's first affordable, inclusionary apartment complex, 2017, and it's very successful.
Okay. What about the transportation hub being in walking distance? Well, why doesn't that qualify as something like smart growth?
It's actually approximately a mile away, and it is a transfer center, not a transit station.
Okay.
And Sandag has re-identified it, and they don't include that. And in fact, it's been identified, the project's been identified as not being smart growth or not being within walking distance.
Okay.
I'd like to dispute that. I haven't seen that anywhere. And if you look at the map on Sandag's website, it still says it's a smart growth node.
Okay.
So I really dispute that.
City staff did, however, in their analysis in recommending that the project not go forward.
City staff had a neutral recommendation. This went through six iterations of a project, went to the Planning Commission twice. The Planning Commission did their job. They sent the project back. There were six revisions to it. And the project got better. It got better over time. And in the end, the city staff made a neutral recommendation to the city council, which then approved it.
Okay. Is that your understanding?
No. The planners recommended to the Planning Commission three different times that the project be denied. And the Planning Commission recommended three different times to the city council that it be denied. On the last time, it was 6-0. It was unanimous. As far as the final city council hearing, you can see in the staff recommendation that they are recommending that it has significant problems that are unmitigable, and for that reason.
Okay. That seems to be pointing at the externalities that the community would have to bear. What do you think those are?
Well, the key one is going to be traffic congestion, and
okay.
That's 7,000 average daily vehicle trips on North River Road. The city also identifies the other congestion points, North River Road, the area by the back gate, College. Those areas will be significantly impacted by this project. And North River Road is a key evacuation route for fire and flood.
Mm-hmm.
And anybody who remembers the Lilac Fire, we had just a short period of time when there was a mandatory evacuation, knows that it took some people, ourselves included, up to 2 hours to evacuate to mm-hmm. another area.
What about the traffic?
I'm really glad you brought that up. I think that it's really disingenuous to point out vehicle trips without recognizing that there are a lot of failing roads in that area that are failing today. If you look at the city's transportation master plan, which I've looked at, it says right out, failing, 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 no money available, no money available, no money available, no funding mechanism available. What North River Farms does, Measure L, is it, at no cost to taxpayers, puts in $7.5 million in traffic improvements, widening College Bridge, adding traffic signals, adding turn lanes, adding a protected bike lane and pedestrian lane alongside the bridge. These are huge improvements, extremely significant. We've created a whole page on our website to show you exactly where the traffic improvements will be, making every road leading to and from the site better and safer and improving traffic.
The city's traffic plan has North River Road designated as a four-lane arterial. The proposal for this development would make it a two-lane with pedestrian and bike. Isn't that restricting it could be someday?
You know, I don't have the plan in front of me, but all of the traffic improvements were very carefully planned with city staff. And as I said, this project went through six iterations. And we're done to recognize that improvements need to be made to these roads no matter what. And the developers, the home builder, is actually going to be putting in a lot of private investment money to pay for these improvements that the taxpayers have no funding source for.
Mm-hmm. One of the improvements is to the bridge, is that
yes,
right?
The College Bridge, I mean, that is an intersection with a lot of issues, and it's no secret. That's an intersection where if you're walking to Del Rio Elementary School, you're walking right next to traffic, and that's going to create a separated pedestrian and bike lane on either side of it, and it's going to make it a lot safer route to school.
Is that your understanding?
That's accurate. From what I understand, they're going to put in a bike lane. It won't widen the lanes any, but it's going to be a wider bike lane pedestrian walk. So that would be nice to have, but putting out 7,000 average daily trips is not going to address the serious problems that already exist. Mm-hmm.
Do you have any idea how many daily trips the road is currently bearing?
Oh, significantly less than that. I don't know what it is mm-hmm. now, but these would be 7,000 additional.
Right. You mentioned the Lilac Fire and the evacuation, but this is the area to the east of this proposed development is all the Morrow Hills agricultural farmland area with a few single family homes scattered here and there. That's not particularly high risk fire territory, is it?
What is for those people living in Morrow Hills, and it is for those people who use North River Road for an evacuation route. So that includes Bonso and Fallbrook.
But it's not brush. It's not. No. It's not the kind of brushy sage.
Well, obviously, yeah, you wouldn't have nearly the human loss by a fire up in Morrow Hills that you would for this project. Uh-huh. If this project was exposed to fire, and there we've had fires going up the riverbed, you know, right mm-hmm. next to this project.
What about the fire risk?
You know, the Oceanside firefighters have never endorsed a project before, and they endorsed this because it's going to make such dramatic improvements to safety. As you correctly mentioned, Kent, this is not a high fire zone. You know, if you look at the CAL FIRE maps, it is not. But at the same time, we recognize careful planning is needed. We always want to plan for fire risk. This not only adds dozens of fire hydrants, clears away flammable brush, and adds fire-resistant vegetation, but builds a new fire station with the truck, with the staffing for it, at no cost to taxpayers. It's going to allow the firefighters to actually finally achieve their response time goal in this area. They're not meeting it now.
The operational cost of that fire station will be borne indefinitely?
This project contributes, I think it's about $1.5-ish million a year in tax revenues, and those are going to pay for public services, including fire. And the firefighters recognize this is going to improve fire safety.
There is a fire station planned for this project. Where would it be?
It would be right in that area, right near, in the North River Road College, in that intersection area.
Okay. It's actually Village 2. It's on the corner of Village 2 in the very southern part of what they call Village 2. Okay.
So it's actually on the property site yes. or the proposed site?
It's next, yes it is, and it's next to the river, and it's next to the three-story homes that'll be next to it.
Doesn't that alleviate a lot of the fire danger by having a station right there?
Well, I think it is for the immediate project. So it's two individuals, one of them's a captain, the other's a paramedic, and I think the main reason for that was because this project didn't satisfy the 5-minute requirement, response time requirement. So it's going to be primarily for medical, but they will have a small, what's called a brush truck on the premises.
Okay, you know, I have to say, I've been really, it's been really problematic to see the misinformation and the attacks on this project. I've seen a lot of inflammatory fear-mongering. I've seen people who are opposed to Measure L sharing photos of enormous fires and so on to scare mm-hmm. people. And quite frankly, this is a fully staffed fire station, and it was planned very carefully. And that's not me saying this. It's the firefighters saying that this is going to provide what they need. They're not meeting those response times now in that whole area, including where you live.
Another externality that exists with any kind of a housing development is what happens to the schools. How does this plan address the impact on public schools?
This is the kind of project that we need to shore up our school system, because right now our school system is losing students every year and losing funding with them. And eventually that becomes a precarious situation financially. This is going to bring in those middle class families that have children, that can bring in life and vibrancy to the district, but even more, it'll provide $5.2 million to the public school system in developer fees. Mm-hmm. And In addition to that, you know, I mentioned the safer routes to school. You know, that elementary school has a population that is predominantly low income. And these are people who, unfortunately, statistically show that low income populations in schools have less safe walks to school. This is going to make it a safer route to school for those kids, too.
What do you think of that?
as far as a safer route, there are no students along North River Road that do attend its Del Rio school. Mm-hmm. Most of those students come from across Vandegrift and also from the back gate area. So it's not going to help them any. It would definitely help those people who lived, or those students who lived in the project, in the development project, but not those individuals outside that project.
I see. You have characterized this as a sprawl development. Isn't it the case that this 176 acres right now could sustain roughly 70 estate-size parcels, or it could be subdivided into what at least some people would argue is real sprawl?
Technically, it could if it was economically feasible.
Okay.
But the reason the 2.5 acre zoning is there is to promote agriculture, so to make it so that the area, that the land doesn't go up in such high amounts that agriculture can't exist. Again, if you had high density, it automatically raises the value of the land. That land is going to go out to some other use. And this developer, that's their model, their business model, is to get the approved designation in the land to a higher use so that the value will go up, and then they usually flip those parcels. They don't build on them, they don't develop them themselves. If you look on Integral's website, you'll see that this is what they do. They get the approvals, change it from low density to high density, then sell the project.
But this isn't considered high density housing, is it?
No.
Can you talk about that?
No, this is, this is a really carefully planned, balanced community. The centerpiece is the working farm. It's an organic farm. The idea is a connection to the land for the people who live there. There's, the farm, the open space, more than half of the site's open space. There's, the biking trails, hiking trails, horse riding trails. And it's a healthy community to live in. It's definitely not a high density community. And actually, this is as I mentioned, it's an ideal place to locate it.
Of the 585 units that if it completely built out, according to this proposal, how much of those, or how many of those 585 were single family, townhouses, how does that break out?
Well, right now it's about, as I said, about 60 affordable apartments, and the rest are multi-generational type living situations, with a home, casita. The idea is being able to have multiple generations living on site, but it's homes.
So 520 single family homes with maybe casitas. Mm-hmm. And 60 or so.
Yep.
Apartments.
Yes, yes.
So is that high density?
I consider it high density. It's approximately 4 dwelling units to the acre over the amount of land that they used. But if you look at a site plan, it's very obvious that it's high density. The land that's designated for agriculture is, and most other projects would be considered to be landscaping. They may have a small community garden, or they may have agriculture. And if you look at the site plan again, you'll see that what they designate as agriculture goes around the edges of the project. And again, agriculture is not consistent with housing, with housing development. The Farm Bureau recommends a 200-foot buffer. There's no 200-foot buffer or anything even close to it.
A 200-foot buffer between what and
between
what?
A housing development or housing and agriculture.
I see.
In the front.
Can you talk about the agriculture in this plan?
Sure, sure. And I would, I also want to say that I think the worst kind of sprawl is the kind of sprawl that Mr. Martinik lives in, which is split. You are living in former farmland that was split up into the 2.5 acre lots. And that's exactly the kind of sprawl you don't want, because there's no planning for infrastructure around it. There's no money that comes for roads. There's no money that comes for fire protection. It's just each person with their own 2.5 acre lot where agriculture used to be. That's what could happen to this site. I'm sorry, you were...
I wanted to ask about, tell us about the agricultural elements of this plan.
Yes. So it's completely disingenuous to say that it doesn't preserve agriculture. We have some of the most respected agricultural advocates in our community who are passionate supporters of our project, including Luana Hallstrom, who is, you know, former president of the National Council of Agricultural Employers. She's a local. She believes in this. She said that this is the future of agriculture in the coastal region here. This is testing out a new model that has worked in hundreds of communities around the country, and it's called a farming community. It's a community that's designed to be compatible with agriculture. Your view, with all due respect, Mr. Martinek, is really outdated, that a community can't live in harmony with agriculture. Of course it can. In fact, that's how communities evolved. This, you know, if you look at Atlanta, if you look at Vermont, if you look at Arizona near Phoenix, there are these communities that have developed models, carefully, professionally managed organic farms like this one, that are right in harmony with the community.
Can you tell us a little bit about what Oceanside has designated as its effort to increase agritourism in the South Morro Hills?
There's a plan that's been going on for, the process has been going on for approximately 4 years. And again, you're looking at agritourism. The plan is an ag revision. It's designated by the city, has been worked on by the city. It's in the planning process, and it will probably be complete in, I would guess, less than a year. It was originally going to be completed by December. And what it's going to do is promote agritourism. I live across the street from a winery. My neighbor grows grapes. I grow macadamia nuts and avocados. Small farms can exist in the area, and the agri vision is going to promote the different types of activities. Bread and breakfast, there's so many things that we can do in the area. But if this project goes through, it's going to pretty much decimate that planning activity, because people are going to want to put, there are a couple landowners that want to put in high density homes, a high density development, so they can make more money on it.
But this proposal butts up against housing already, and a church and a golf course, right?
Not really. If you look to see the site plan again, there's 1 acre zoning that acts as a buffer between this agricultural parcel and another neighborhood. You have the Arrowwood Golf Course that acts as a buffer for another part of the agriculture. And this was in the past planning that we've done over the last 40 years. You also have Bonso, which is 2 acre zoning, and you have Fallbrook, which is 2 acre zoning. So this land is already buffered by land planning that works.
In the plan, for the agricultural elements, whatever kind of marketplace, garden, who owns and runs and operates all that into the future?
Well, we found a professional operator, a nonprofit called the Ecology Center, who has agreed to run this farm. They already have an organic farm, and they're gonna have a farmer's market. They're gonna operate it professionally. And this is not gonna be, I mean, I wanna debunk the idea that this is going to be a big industrial farm with crop dusters going over. It's not like that. We're talking about a professionally managed organic farm that is compatible with homes and allows people to be close to the land and agriculture, and more importantly, have that locally sourced fresh food supply chain that we don't have now. We have a lot of farmers in South Morro Hills, and they're growing ornamental plants, or they're growing vegetables that are trucked and shipped long distances. You can't go buy a local tomato or a local kale very easily. There's not a farmer's market around there. And this is going to create a model that local farmers support.
What about the idea that this kind of flies in the face of the agritourism initiative that the city's been talking about?
Absolutely not. This is going to advance agritourism. And, you know, I really have a problem as, you know, if somebody with a young family, two little kids, a husband, you know, we only recently bought our house, and, you know, we bought a very modest house. And there are a lot of families like me who can't afford to live in Oceanside. I just talked to one who commutes here from Temecula, and they would love to just buy a nice house close to the land, you know, in line with agricultural traditions, just because you have yours and you have your house and you're happy with your house and your house is appreciated and you don't want to let in any new homes, doesn't mean that you should be allowed to say no to housing for the rest of us.
Is there a NIMBYism kind of not in my backyard element to
this?
There's
not. It's a matter of good planning. And it's a situation where we have an agricultural area preserved. People want to be able to promote agritourism and agriculture. Over the years, agriculture has gone through different transitions. Way back when you had olive trees, then you had grapes, then you had avocados. Now you had citrus for a period of time. Now we're moving back towards grapes. So it can be viable. And what they're promoting, again, if you look at the site plan, you can see this is not an agricultural or agricultural-friendly project. Mm-hmm. If the city council would have advised them to wait, going back a couple of years when they started, until this AgriVision was completed. And it's in the works now. Their staff is working full-time on it, and you're getting a lot of participation from our area. So you've got to look to see if you want a high-density development, housing development, or if you want this agritourism that gives farmers choices. And you can't tell farmers whether or not they can sell their crops local or whether it's going to be somewhere else.
But shouldn't farmers also have a right to sell their property and take advantage of the capital gains from the property by selling it to a developer?
I agree, within the law. And the law we have right now is a zoning ordinance that says that's agricultural land. What you're getting is there's some larger property owners, and this developer wants to basically get entitlements to this land that are different. So, you know, should they be able to do this? Should they change the contract that the city has in terms of a general plan to make it so that they can make more money? And this is a money-run project.
I have to say, I think it's really wishful thinking to say that this land is going to be agriculture in perpetuity with the underlying zoning that it has. The land use designation that land has means that when that farming is no longer feasible, that can be split up into that 2.5 acre lot size.
That's it.
And, you know, I keep hearing about the agritourism plan. This is a plan that is supported by farmers. Farmers say that North River Farms and Measure L is going to bring in the kind of infrastructure improvements and demonstrate the concept of the locally grown food supply chain that's going to help agritourism. I talked to a woman who lives right next to North River Farms. She raises horses and dogs, and she would love to be able to have some kind of horse lesson. You know, she wants to be part of it.
She wants to sell her land at a higher price.
This is going to, this is going to have a great impact on her property.
Is there a risk that this is kind of, I suppose, a nose of the camel problem, or maybe the whole camel's head, in the tint of seeing all of South Morro Hills flip to basically a housing or a series of housing developments?
Well, in talking to farmers locally who really believe in this project and have educated me about the farming situation, it is getting harder and harder to farm in coastal areas, and that's because the land prices are high, water's expensive, regulations, many factors, competition from other markets. There are a lot of pressures on farming, and it's naive to think that just because somebody's farming it today, it's going to be farmed in perpetuity. You cannot count on that. You have to have a plan, and this is the plan to preserve agriculture.
Hang on, we can't all talk at once.
So this is a plan that preserves agriculture. It is a thoughtful, intentional, carefully planned vision to have an 88-acre farm the size of 67 football fields. That is how to preserve it.
No, what you do is economically you set zoning on the land so that it's conducive for agriculture. And the way you do is the 2.5 acre zoning isn't going to be turning into estate lots that the accusations have been. It'll encourage farmers to keep their land and to develop different crops.
San Diego County has somewhere in the neighborhood of a quarter of a million, 250,000 acres, I believe it is, of agricultural land right now. Is it significant that we're talking about 176 acres here?
It is, and that's part of the 3,500 acres of South Morro Hills. And 85% of the landowners in that area do not want this project. There was a poll that was done about a year and a half ago of the people who own the land in that area. They see it as having an impact on the proposals that are going forward to encourage agriculture in our area.
What about that notion that the city should maintain a agricultural element of, I guess, bigger commercial farming, so on and so forth? Who owns the land right now?
This let me see. I can't tell you right off the top of my head who owns the land. I'm representing the campaign, but don't have that level of detail. But the
Self-Realization Fellowship owns the land now.
Oh, okay.
But the, you know, I think what I said earlier holds true, and that is that there are a lot of pressures that are facing farmers. And by doing nothing, by allowing that land to stay with the underlying estate lot designation, that doesn't help farming. I dispute that there was a survey that it found that conclusion, because we had 1,400 letters of support for this project. We have lots of local farmers who
there
came
aren't
out.
That many people.
Excuse me,
in
I'd like to finish my sentence.
Yeah, I feel like
excuse
I'm being filibustered here.
Wait, guys. You finish, and then Dennis, I'll turn it to you.
So there are many farmers locally who supported, who came out during the project, and that's a matter of public record.
Dennis.
There are a handful of farmers who would like to sell their land for higher value, so they want to make the land more intense, so it's compatible. The problem is that they don't realize that this project takes so much of the infrastructure and uses that they're not going to be able to sell their land or get a developer to take it over, because that infrastructure has got to be replaced, and it's going to be so expensive for them to build the roads and the sewers and all to do that. So this project is going to hurt them, and they don't realize it. The vast majority, I don't know where you get 1,400 people who support it. We only have a couple hundred landowners in South Morro Hills. And again, a poll was done by the South Morro Hills Association, and people adamantly want be able to keep a 2.5-acre zoning to maintain the agriculture mm-hmm. in the area. And 2.5-acre zoning does that. It is economics. And small farming can proliferate, especially with an agritourism-type concept or vision.
What's currently being grown on this property?
They've had three different crops, I believe, this year. Tomatoes, peppers, and I think kale was the most recent. They're planting it now. It's prime. It's designated by the state as prime agricultural land. It's really productive, and again, it's being used for agricultural foods.
And I assume on a lease basis to the farmer.
I assume so.
Is that?
That's my understanding.
Okay. Were there significant impacts in the environmental report that were inadequately or accounted for?
Oh, yes. It's very clear. That's one of the main reasons that the planning staff and the planning commission voted strongly against this project. And the main one, of course, is traffic. It's the most obvious. The other is that it conflicts with agriculture. And it's brought out in the environmental impact report that it will have significant growth-inducing impacts. That will basically start the process of high density developments throughout Morro Hills.
Mm-hmm. Could you give us an outline of the changes that have been made to this proposal as it's gone through the process? Because it originally started out as a much more dense project, and then the developers have added a number of things. Can you outline those for us?
Absolutely. The project got better over time, for sure. The Planning Commission gave input. The community gave input, and the home builder went back to the drawing board several times, six times, and added public benefits. For example, adding size to the farm acreage, reducing the number of housing units, adding in public benefit with the fire improvements. There were a number of changes that went through, adding in the traffic improvements and increasing the investment in that. And as a result, you know, the project really does a lot of great things for this area. And I just want to reflect that this is a tiny corner of Oceanside. This is not going to have Oceanside-wide traffic impacts. We're talking about one area that's going to have much better traffic flow because of much optimized signalization, optimized turn lanes, widened intersections. It's just going to help traffic flow in that area.
That's not what the environmental impact report says.
Okay.
And the traffic analysis says the same thing. 7,000 average daily trips generated from this project on a road that is the main evacuation route for fires and floods. And there are some serious flood problems that we've had in that area. That whole southern portion of that lot was underwater going back a few years ago.
The southern portion of the
south of North River Road,
so okay.
That part of the project that's right next to the San Luis Rey River.
I see. The developer has, over time, made changes and improvements, added, I guess you could, in one sense, you could call them sweeteners to this to this project. Absent the idea of it not going forward at all, is there something that should be added?
Well, they've gone from a ridiculous project to a less ridiculous project. And as far as what they could do is they could make it like other agri-hoods that they're calling this project, and make it so that it's less dense with more land that's actually devoted to. And these are things that could have been worked out in the planning for it that is in the process right now. So they should come back with a much less density and more agriculture.
They did double the amount of property there, or land that's designated for agriculture, as this proposal has evolved. Isn't that the case?
No, that's not true. What they did, they bought one parcel called the Brie Parcel, which is 36.5 acres. It's already been approved for one home per acre, so basically 1 acre lots, 27 homes, and that's to act as part of the buffer. In planning, and my doctorate's in urban planning, okay, I'm a retired professor of business economics and urban planning. Key thing in planning is that you buffer areas to reduce conflicts. And this project doesn't do it. The Brie project would have done this by having more equestrian, possibly people who raise dogs, other animals, other animal husbandry.
Mm-hmm. What do you think? They have made, well, let's do it this way. Can you tell us, for the agriculture that is anticipated by the proposal, what kinds of things do you think are going to go on in this area?
You know, that level of detail is going to be worked out with the Ecology Center. They have a really robust farm right now that I've actually tried some of the produce from, and they have a very dynamic system. They have all kinds of heirloom vegetables that are grown in an organic, sustainable fashion. So I think they're going to go with the crops that do best in the area.
Okay.
Esther, who's paying for it?
Who's paying for it?
Who pays for the farms?
This is part of the project. This is built in. You know, one of the biggest expenses for farming is the land. You know, this is a big piece of land that they're able to farm.
It'd be a community facilities district paid for by the people in that project. And that's why the amount of income that those people have to earn is so high, because they're dumping different Melrose financing or Melrose obligations on them. It's a community facilities district. Same thing with the fire station. You asked about that. Mm-hmm. The people there will be doing it through a community facilities district, and then what isn't paid by them will be paid for by general taxpayers in the city.
Is that
this
the
is
case?
This is gonna attract people who are committed to a healthy, sustainable lifestyle and connection with the land. They're gonna buy into this community knowing that this is part of what they're buying into. You know, they're choosing this community because they want to live in a farming area. They want this to be part of the benefits. I personally would much rather live around an organic farm than a golf course. I think it's, you know, that's one way to plan a community. This is a new way to plan a community. This is a really concept that's working in hundreds of communities around the country.
Are there estimates been prepared on what the HOA and Melrose fees would be on
the Kaiser Marston?
I don't have that level of detail at my fingertips, because obviously there's a range of different housing mm-hmm. levels within it. And I believe he's quoting the income needed for a median level. You know, he's not quoting the entry level housing cost.
Any idea?
No, that's true. Yeah, that is median. $167,000 would be the average that people would pay.
No, I was wondering if you had any information about what kind of HOA and Melrose fees there would be on a typical unit.
The Kaiser Marston study shows that instead of paying 1.25% for property taxes, the people in this project would be paying 1.75%. So significantly, a 50% increase in their taxes. Okay. That's because of the Melrose and Community Facility District obligations that they would have under the project. It turns out to be a very expensive place to live.
Some people argue that development in Southern California generally should be halted because of the issue of having to import water for mm-hmm. here. What do we do about the water demand that this or any other development does in the city of Oceanside?
Well, you know, the water pressure is real, and that's part of the reason that farmers are having such a hard time with these large commercial industrial farms. This project is built very water smart. It's got native vegetation. It's got gray water systems for every home. It's built sustainably. And quite frankly, it'll use a lot. If you look at the documents, it'll use, I don't have exactly the figure, but a lot less water than the farming.
Okay. That's not true. The infrastructure analysis done for this project, which is a study available on the city's website again, says it will use 2.37 times the amount of water that agriculture is presently using on the project. It's going to significantly impact the water use in that area.
Are there issues with regard to sewer and wastewater treatment that the project somehow creates?
Actually, this project, again, one of the reasons this is an ideal area for this kind of project is that there are lines, you know, there are sewer, water, power lines running in this area, and $80 million in infrastructure is going to be spent by this home builder to upgrade infrastructure. That includes the traffic improvements, that includes the fire improvements, it also includes improving all of the connections to the sewer, to the water. It's going to benefit everybody in that area by strengthening the resilience of that system.
It'll benefit the people living in those projects. It's typical fees that a developer pays.
$80
million. There was an integral attempted to stop this ballot measure from going forward by lawsuits. Was that fair?
So I'm a spokesperson for Yes on L. Mm-hmm. I'm not a spokesperson for Integral per se. I'm here for this campaign.
Okay.
So I can't speak to the details of that litigation, but I do know that the home builder really believed that there was cause to question, you know, question whether this was done properly. They brought it to a court. The court made a ruling, and my understanding is they're not appealing it. So that was a question that the court had to look at.
Okay. Dennis?
The big corporation trying to bully people in basically a grassroots movement. And it's going to be interesting to see how the final figures come out as far as what they're spending to put this project down and what we're spending. But that's not fair. I mean, you know, it was a slap suit, and the judge threw it out and kind of laughed at the attorney that brought the suit forward. I don't understand why they would do it, because they were just fishing for something to have the suit thrown out. Mm-hmm. And the only reason I could see the attorney doing this for increasing his billable hours, mm-hmm. because that's what happened in it.
Do either of you have any sense of how the electorate views in Oceanside views this project?
Well, speaking of bullies, I think that the small group that brought forward this referendum is showing exactly how you can manipulate the process. You know, the home builder did not put this on the ballot. The opponents put it on the ballot. The home builder went through a 5-year planning process, did everything right, checked all the boxes, jumped through all the hoops, revised the project, revised it again, did the EIR, did everything right. And then you have a small group of people who can come forward, gather signatures, and put it on the ballot to overturn it. The problem with that is it is an uphill battle for us, because regardless of the millions of dollars put into planning this and all the time that was put in, voters tend to vote no, because they don't care. They don't understand about this. This is a little project that's not going to affect most people in Oceanside. Their people are busy. They're working. They don't have time to go research this. And so, unfortunately, it's kind of a shame, but voters tend to vote no because they haven't researched it.
Do you have any polling to suggest which way the wind is blowing on this proposition?
I think that the wind is not at our back. I think that, you know, it's an uphill battle for us, because mm-hmm. voters, you know, if you look at, and this is the playbook for anywhere this happens in Southern California, where NIMBYs put something on the ballot, they know that the odds are voters will default to no because they haven't had the time to study and understand it.
Do you have any sense of the electorate?
Just individuals that we've talked to in circulating our information, and when they hear 7,000 average daily trips, and they're familiar with this project, and they're familiar with what they did in the SOAR initiative, which mm-hmm. would have also put this project before the voters. Mm-hmm. And they remember some of the bullying tactics there. I mean, I had people, when I was gathering signatures, I had individuals come up to me and yell at the people that I was asking to sign my petition. You know, they're definitely aggressive in their maneuvers. And as far as outspending, they spent us 40-1 for the SOAR initiative, and I imagine this will be much, much more than that.
So you don't have any polling data or access to anything like that?
That costs money, and we don't have the money to do it.
Just asking.
Oh, yeah, right.
We're kind of getting close on time. I'm going to throw this open. You guys have kind of done it already. If you had the opportunity to ask Tanya a question, what would it be?
It'd probably be related to how would you estimate the amount of money that the people who are going to live in that project are, how much would they have to pay? Who is paying for the fire department? And who is paying for the different guards? Isn't it the people who actually live there?
Well, a huge upfront investment is being made in that. As I said, $80 million in infrastructure at no cost to taxpayers. Yes, there are HOA fees. I have to say, I've lived in communities with HOA fees. That's pretty standard in California. And that's not something to be afraid of. You know, if you have a benefit with the community that you live in, then you buy into that community and you buy into the fees that you'll pay as part of that to have access to those benefits.
Okay, and turn about being fair play, do you have a question that you would ask of the no side?
So I'd like to know, why are you such a big advocate for ballot box planning?
Well, ballot box planning means that people get to vote on it. In this situation, we had a planning commission and planners who were ignored by the city council. And I hope you're saying that people don't have a right to vote on issues, especially significant ones like this. This will affect their lives. It means a lot to them. Just the idea of the fire dangers and the other, the tax implications of this on the community make it so that they want to vote on certain key big issues.
The city council is, if I understand correctly, changed the general plan designation for this area. So if this ballot measure fails, what are the consequences of that redesignation of this property?
What will happen is that if the no on L people win, if we win, it'll mean that it goes back and starts all over again. They would have to submit a new project.
Okay. Is that your understanding of what where the ground is if this fails for you?
I believe that the home builder might be able to come back and submit another project.
Okay. After a year.
But it is a bit of a hypothetical, so.
Yeah, okay. I'd like to go back and ask one more thing about North River Road per se. If the traffic load is as large as that prediction, and the city decides that it really needs to be a four-lane road as an arterial rather than a secondary collector road, what then? Who ends up paying for that? Isn't that?
Well, that's part of what the city's transportation master plan is supposed to address. And unfortunately, as it says in several areas, it says both in the plan and it says in the environmental documents for North River Farms and the transportation related documents, which I've looked over, it says no funding mechanism has been identified for many of these things, and it would not be feasible or fair to have one entity bear the full cost because it's a huge public project. Mm-hmm. So that would probably be addressed in the planning process, you know, finding a mechanism for that, finding, you know, that's a question for the planning department down the road. But, you know, I think that what's significant is, you know, I heard Mr. Martinek say that, oh, this is, they're just putting in what any other developer would put in. No, they're not. They're putting in so much more. I spoke with a high-level official at Sandag who deals with transportation planning for some of the largest projects, and he said, $80 million, wow. He said, that is huge. That is a lot to put in for a project of this size.
We're about out of time. Dennis, you want to respond to that?
As far as what they're putting in is basically to service that project. It's true that the North River Road is not going to be expanded. All the more reason for keeping it in agriculture or some limited uses, not high density housing development that generates 7,000 average daily trips a year.
Okay.
Excuse me, a day.
All right, we are basically out of time for the discussion. Dennis, would you like to do a little bit of a closing statement for a minute?
Sure, I just want to say that urban planning and economics are based on common sense. Common sense should not allow decision makers to approve a project, a high density housing project that increases the risk to people in a fire area and also an area that's prone to floods. This project will have significant negative impacts on the community. By voting no on L, we can eliminate those risks. Okay, we could probably, we would save taxes, we'd also save agriculture in the area, and would probably save lives.
Mm. Tanya, a closing remark.
Right, you know, we're hearing more of the fear-mongering. You know, we've already established in this conversation that this is not in a fire hazard area. We've established that this project is gonna make substantial traffic investments and improve traffic flow for everybody. And we've established that it's gonna actually improve fire safety. But you still keep hearing these old, tired statements. And unfortunately, that's the fear-mongering that people who live in Oceanside are gonna have to listen to. I hope they can see through it. I hope they can see the community benefits of this project. It offers so much. It's planned as a healthy, sustainable community that's gonna, it's gonna preserve agriculture in a way that you just can't count on otherwise.
I'd like to thank you both, Tanya Castaneda and Dennis Martinek, for being here talking through this this interesting ballot measure for us. Please remember to vote. Every registered voter will receive a mail-in ballot during the week of October 5th. Ballots can be returned via the U.S. Postal Service and can be tracked at sdvote.com. You can drop off your mail-in ballot earlier at one of four drop-off locations here in Oceanside. Also, polling places will be open for 4 days leading up to the election day on November 3rd. There you can drop off your filled-in ballot or exchange it for a paper ballot to vote in person. I'm Kent Davey. This has been North County Roundtable. Thank you for watching.